Good morning. Let us talk about encoder circuit for an n comma k linear block code. Till now we have spoken about what is a linear block code and how can a code vector be obtained given the data vector, k bit data vector. How do I get the n bit code vector in an n comma k block code? Now we'll try to continue the same and let's try to obtain the encoder circuit for a linear block code. We know that the linear equations defining the block code could be written as C1 is equal to D1 or M1, provided you call the data as message. You can name it anything. Naming conventions, we are free to use anything. And the first k bits of the code vector will be same as data vector. So till CK is equal to DK, I'll get the data same as code. The next n minus k bits, these n minus k bits are the check bits or parity bits, and they depend on the data bits in a linear manner. We have used linear equations showing the dependence of the check bits on the data bits. So these are all the linear equations. We have to realize this using some hardware. That's the encoder circuit. So looking at this equations, we can easily decide what hardware do we need. We can say the hardware requirement is as follows. First thing, we need a k-bit shift register. Why? To shift in the data. I have k-bit data, so I have to shift in the data bit by bit at a time. I need a k-bit shift register. Then I'll need n minus k modulo 2 adders. The modulo 2 adders are needed to realize this part of the equations. All these additions are mod 2 additions, I have told you before. Any additions which we do here in ITC is mod 2 or XOR gate. So in order to realize all these last n minus k linear equations to get the check bits, I need n minus k mod 2 adders. Then we see we have the parity bits multiplying the data bits. So we have to have switches or multipliers to realize this. I need to have switches or multipliers to realize the Pij values. Then we also need an n segment commutator for serial data transmission. So all these n code bits have to be transmitted serially on an output line, for which I need to use a n segment commutator. So these are the four major hardware components that are needed to realize a linear block code defined with these equations. Now let's try to draw the diagram for the same. You see this rightmost segment, which we have shown piece by piece here, arcs, represents the n bit commutator. So what is the job of this commutator? We will have a central line connected from the center. At the edge, there is a brush. It's known as commutator brush. Every time this line and brush comes into contact with one code segment. See, on every segment, we have one code bit. Bit C1 is connected to this segment. Bit C2 is connected to the next. C3 will be connected to this segment, so on. Okay. So to every of these commutator segments, one particular code bit is connected. And whenever the brush comes into contact with that particular segment, whatever data is available here, that is data corresponding to bit C1, will be sent out on the transmission line. So this data will be collected through this brush and it will move out on the final output transmission line. So each time I have to read one complete code word, this brush should make one rotation. from C1 to CN, it should touch all the segments once. So it would collect all the data bits and it would send it on the output lines. Next, the K bit shift register, which I told, is shown here. The K bit shift register stores the data bits from D1 to DK. So you should have the input coming from your left, and slowly all the K data bits, once they are available, they are stored in this shift register. That is the K bit shift register, the N segment commutator. Now let's come to the multipliers. I have to realize equations in the form, say P11 into D1. So P11 into D1 means I'll take this bit D1 and I will use a multiplier P11. This multiplier value can either be a 1 or a 0. So multiply data bit D1 with P11 and pass it on to the mod 2 adder. Similarly, you take data bit D2, multiply it with the multiplier P21, pass it on to the same adder. And finally, data bit DK multiplied with PK1, passed on to the same adder. This shows the realization of the equation CK plus 1. See here, what is CK plus 1? Observe, P11 into D1, P21 into D2, so on, PK1 into DK. See whether we are getting the same. P11 into D1, P21 into D2, PK1 into DK. Yes, we are able to get the same thing when I pass this through a final modulo 2 adder. So this generates the first check bit CK plus 1. Likewise, we will generate all the check bits using the multipliers and modulo 2 adders. See, these multipliers can also simply be switches. That means if it is a 1, then it is a closed connection. See, and if it is a 0, it will be an open connection, no contact. Closed connection whenever it is a 1, this part, this P21 can also be a switch. It can be a closed connection whenever it is a 1, means this end will touch this end. It is closed. Otherwise, it should be an open connection when this multiplier or the parity value is a 0. For 0, it is open switch. For 1, it is a closed switch. Okay. And now, finally, the last equation is also shown here. See, Cn is P1 n minus k D1, P2 n minus k D2, so on. The same thing is shown here. P1 n minus k into D1. See, the D1 bit is coming here. P2 n minus k into D2. Yes. And finally, PK n minus k into DK. So all these values are corresponding to this last equation. And from this last equation, everything is passed on to the modulo 2 adder. You can see everything comes to this modulo 2 adder, which is finally passed on to the, this is also all these modulo 2 adders, which bit does it generate? So you see, okay, if the first check bit is generated by this, the last check bit will be generated by the last modulo 2 adder. So yeah, now it is working. This CN, this corresponds to CN, which is fed to the last commutator segment. So finally, we have realized the encoder circuit for N, K linear block code. And this commutator brush will run at a high speed It will sweep through all the code bits once to send one complete code word on the transmission line serially. Please observe, this is serial transmission. Okay, so this is how we realize the encoder circuit. Now let's take an example, how to draw the encoder circuit for a 7,4 linear block code with C5 given as M1 plus M3 plus M4. C6 is M1 plus M2 plus M4, C7. So we already have the linear equations defining the check bits. What should we do? How many bit? It's a 7,4 code. N is 7, K is 4. So I have to have, what are the hardware requirement? The hardware needed. What should be the hardware? First is a 4-bit shift register. I need a 4-bit shift register. Then what else do I need? I need a 7-segment commutator. Right, N segment commutator, and how many modulo 2 adders? N minus K, 7 minus 4, which is approximately 3 mod 2 adders I need. And what else? We need multipliers or switches to realize the P values. Here we don't exclusively write it as P. But whenever this message bit is included, that means its corresponding P is 1. Okay, I'll show you how to realize this. So here, let's draw the commutator segment first. It should be a 7-segment commutator. Okay, and from the center, I will have a commutator brush or contact connected to one of the bits. This is C1, this can be C2, C3, C4, C5, C6, C7. Okay, so we are done with the commutator, and this would be your transmission line. What should we do next? Next, we need to have a K-bit shift register. So this is input, and this shift register should be taking in K data bits. Let me say M1, M2, M3, M4. I have 4 data bits. Right? Because it's 7,4 code. Those 4 data bits will be input serially to this shift register. And what should be the connection here? I'll have to connect this message bit M1 to code bit C1, message bit M2 to C2, M3 to C3, and contact is going away. Okay, M4 to C4. So we have to connect like this. And now I have to realize these 3 equations. So the equations are C5 is M1 plus M3 plus M4. So I'll consider the modulo 2 adder here to generate C5. And what are the inputs for C5? It should include M1, M3, plus M4. All these 3 are input to generate C5, correct, from this equation. So here for those P values, we have simply used short circuits. Next, C6. C6 need to be realized using a linear combination of M1, M2, M4. So I'll tap this same thing, M1, then we have M2, M4. This generates C6. And lastly, C7. I need C7. The inputs are M1, M2, M3. So again, M1, M2, we'll tap M2 from here. See, wherever there is a connection, we are showing it with a darkened dot. If the lines cross each other without this darkened dot, there is no connection. So we have M1, M2 and M3. M3 is the third input here. So for each of these modulo 2 adders, I have 3 inputs each, and they generate the check bits or the parity bits, which will be added as redundant information to the data to create a proper linear block code vector. So this is how we draw the circuit of the encoder in a linear block code. Now, let's move on to the next topic, which is known as parity check matrix. This is another very important concept in linear block codes. The parity check matrix, also denoted as capital H. So this parity check matrix is denoted as capital H. It is a n-tuple, an n-tuple if V is a code word. Here, instead of V, we'll call it C. If C is a code word generated using the generator G, and if and only if this C into H transpose, we'll define this H now. C into H transpose, that's H transpose matrix, if it will be a zero. So please understand, this H matrix or the parity check matrix is very important in determining whether a given code vector is valid or not. It will be a valid code vector whenever I multiply that code vector with the transpose of this H matrix, the parity check matrix. Only if you get a zero, then it is valid. Okay. If you don't get a zero, then it would be invalid. So this matrix H is called as parity check matrix of the code. It is very useful matrix in finding the errors and correcting them. So it helps in error detection and correction. It's a very, very useful matrix. The dimension of this matrix will be n minus k cross n. So please remember the dimension of all matrices. The dimension of G is K cross N. The dimension of P is K cross N minus K. K rows and N minus K columns, the parity matrix. Whereas the dimension of H transpose matrix is N minus K cross N. It will have N minus K rows and N columns. Okay. See how the H matrix is defined. If this G matrix is defined as identity followed by parity, then H matrix will be defined as parity transpose followed by identity of order N minus K. So please understand this correctly. Whenever I define the generator matrix as identity first followed by parity, we call this as systematic form, right? Then the H matrix or the parity check matrix will be defined as transpose of the parity matrix appended with the identity matrix of order N minus K. So if we represent this in terms of each bit, Here, H is P transpose I n minus k. So the transpose of the P matrix will look like this. I have P11, P21, so on along the rows, and P11, P12, P1 n minus k along the column. If you remember, we had written, here you can observe this P11, P21 was along the column in the parity matrix. Now, and this was along the row P11. Now we have interchanged that. Here, it has taken transpose. P transpose looks like this, and identity matrix of order n minus k is appended. Okay. So this represents our H. And one more thing here. Suppose you write G. I told you another way of writing G is parity first and then the identity. So if I write G like this, then what should be the representation for P? P should be written as I n minus k first, followed with transpose of the parity matrix. Here in the generator, if you have parity first, in the this is parity check matrix H, not P. Here in the parity check matrix, I will have identity first and then the P transpose. Okay. So please remember, normally we use I followed with P in linear block codes. So very common representation of H is P transpose I n minus k. As I told you, this is a very important matrix used in error detection and correction. So for error detection and correction, our H matrix is very, very important. Please remember that. Now, let's try to make one very useful analysis. We have to prove that C into H transpose is equal to zero. In the sense, whenever I have a valid code vector and I multiply it with the transpose of the H matrix, I should get the all zero code vector. Okay. So if this is true, then the code vector is whatever you have used is perfect. Everything is correct. So in order to prove this proof, we know that H is represented as P transpose I n minus k. So I have written the rows and columns of this matrix. Okay, let's call this equation 1. Now, the ith row of the generator matrix I need. So remember the generator matrix. Let me show you. Here. Yeah, this is the generator matrix. What will be the ith row of this matrix? It will be, ith row will be something like this. Ith row will have all zeros. It will have one in the ith position and followed with zeros. And here it will have PI1, PI2, so on. Yes or no? So we have represented that directly here. You observe. The ith row of the generator matrix will have all zeros followed with one. This position is the ith position. The ith element will be one, again followed with all zeros. And when it comes to the parity here, it has PI1, PI2, so on till PIJ, which is the K plus jth element. And P I n minus k is the last element. So how does this work? You see, why is this k plus jth element? Remember, your generator matrix is of order k cross k. So till here I have completed, till here I would have completed k elements. And after here, to come to the position Pij, I have moved another j elements. So this is k plus j. Okay. Okay, it's not giving the pen. Excuse me. Okay, you can see, hence this will be the k plus jth element, because to the first k elements of the identity, we have moved j elements more or j columns more to get the value Pij. So this will become the k plus jth element, and the last element is Pi n minus k. So in order to prove this, first I'll consider the ith row of the generator matrix. Then I'll consider the jth row of the parity check matrix, H matrix. Can you write the jth row of this matrix? First row is P11, P21, so on. Second row is P12. So what will the jth row be? P1j. We should start with P1j. As you can see, Hj. The jth row of H matrix will be P1j, P2j. And if I move on to the ith element, I want the ith element here. It will be Pij. And so on, it will go on till Pkj. Okay. This point, at this point will be, it will be Pkj. Till here, I have completed k elements totally. Then we are following it with the identity matrix of n minus k elements. So I'll just write identity matrix. I'm going to write all zeros and I'll have one. I'll assume, because this is the jth row, I should have one in the k plus jth position. K positions for the first k bits of the parity transpose matrix. And after moving another j positions, I'll get a 1 here in the identity matrix, because this is the jth row. Jth row will have a 1 in the jth position. Okay. So this is the jth row of the parity check matrix, and the ith row of the generator matrix is given. Now, let us find the inner product of Gi into Hj transpose. I'm taking the generator matrix directly as row wise, but I'm taking a transpose of this parity check vector. Both are row vectors. So if I take Hj transpose, see all these elements, I should take transpose of this. It will look something like this. You see, this is Gi. Whatever we have written horizontally row wise, this is Gi. And whatever we have written column wise is the Hj transpose. Now, if you observe carefully, whenever I multiply this, you can observe carefully here. This, what is happening? The ith element of this Gi is 1. The corresponding element of this Hj is Pij. Right? Till that place, it is all zeros. Till reaching that place here, it's all zeros. Only when the ith element here is 1, I have Pij here. So I'll get 1 into Pij written in the equation. All others are zeros. Again, we have zeros here. And it will end at this point. When I get a Pij in this row, the generator row, the corresponding k plus jth element will be a 1 in this Hj transpose. So if you have observed in this, the corresponding elements. That's why we have marked. We have marked the ith element and the k plus jth element, and you can see how they correspond to each other. So that when I do a inner product of gi into hj transpose, I am going to get pij into 1 plus pij into 1, which turns out to be 0. Remember, it's modulo 2 addition. 1 plus 1 is a 0. Pij into 1 plus 1 will result in 0. Okay. So this proves that G into H transpose is 0. And what did I have to prove? Actually, I started off to prove C into H transpose is 0. I had to prove C into H transpose is 0. But first, now I have proved. So since we know GI into HJ transpose is 0, I can generalize it. So generalizing this result, I'll say what? G into H transpose is 0 always for all rows of the generator and all rows of the parity check. Whenever I multiply, it will result in a 0. Okay. So finally, how do you prove C into? So how do we prove? Therefore, C we know can be, if I just multiply, or you just say here, multiply both sides with what? Both sides with the data matrix. So what will you get? D into G into H transpose is equal to 0, because the right hand side D into 0 will give you 0. But what is D into G? D into G we know is C. Therefore, the code matrix C, which is equal to data into generator into H transpose, is always 0. Okay, so this is the proof for, and this statement easily tells us that whenever you have a valid code vector and you multiply that valid code vector with the H transpose matrix, transpose of the parity check, you should always get the result as a 0. Only when it is not valid, you'll get the result as a non-zero value. Okay, so let's stop here and continue in the next class.